Welcome to Geomantic Information Systems and the Mysteries of Amiens Cathedral. The story of John the Baptist is told in much of the artwork at Amiens Cathedral, and the head of John the Baptist is said to be located there. Amiens Cathedral is one of the places discussed at length in Fulcanelli's book, Mystery of the Cathedrals. As in other places we've studied here, the octagonal labyrinth of Amiens may include directional attributes that were valued by its makers. So we'll examine that, and thanks for joining me. The octagonal form of the labyrinth at Amiens may descend from the Tower of the Winds in Athens, Greece. The Tower of the Winds was somewhat of a time laboratory and cartography experiment where people could establish a prime meridian and establish pertinent directions known as a templum that extended from these octagons. So Amiens Cathedral is no different. And we're going to see some interesting associations that may relate directly to the Stuart clan and descendants of Robert the Bruce of Scotland. First, we're going to have a look at the eastern orientation of the cathedral, or the long axis, and later we'll look at the transept, or the southerly azimuths or arcs on the globe that seem to be suggested by the building itself and the octagon within it. So to the east we see a very interesting association that spans the globe to the east, where we have the octagon of Amiens Cathedral pointing to the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. This is an amazing association in which both octagons are related to each other. It's octagon to octagon. So this is an interesting reference. We see the Amiens Cathedral having said to have been built by the Knights Templar, or have their influence and philosophy built into the symbology there. And if you read Mystery of the Cathedrals, you will read Fulcanelli's view that the cathedral has millennial themes in some of the stonework, similar to the Great Cross of Vendée. And we will explore its relationship to the Great Cross as well. But for now, this relationship to the Dome of the Rock is somewhat amazing, and also mimics some of the other relationships we've seen in octagons that seem to have been valued by this certain group of people. And we do know from previous observations that the Dome of the Rock points to the Vatican, and the array of windrows at the Vatican points back to the Dome of the Rock. So it's not unusual for these directional attributes to be associated with octagonal structures like this. Now the next association we'll examine is the southerly orientation, or slightly southwest, in which an azimuth or arc on the globe can be drawn using the heading of this building, or the way it's oriented on the globe. Part of what we're seeing are these buildings are like compass rows placed on the face of the earth. And we know that Amiens and the Great Cross of Vendée are prominently featured in Fulcanelli's Mysteries of the Cathedrals. So it's no coincidence that this southerly orientation points directly to the Great Cross of Hendaye, or the Great Cyclical Cross of Hendaye. Now, what other associations might we have? It's amazing that both are discussed in the book, and Amiens points to the Great Cross, but we also have the Battle of Teba included on this azimuth, which is very interesting, given the value of Scottish royalty, descendants of Robert the Bruce, interest in the octagonal shape and associated directions, as in the Tower of the Winds of Athens. And the Battle of Teba is the place where Sir Douglas bore Robert the Bruce's heart into battle and was slain himself, along with other Scottish noblemen, such as members of the Sinclair family and others too. And the name Lockhart, of one of the Scottish survivors of the battle, the name was changed to Lockhart due to the association with Robert the Bruce's heart. And we may also see some very interesting associations between Scottish royalty and the Camino de Santiago and Santiago de Compostela. There's a lot of a symbolic association with later Scottish Jacobite symbology in the King James, or Iago, valued by the Jacobites, and we see the Latin name of James is even Jacobus, and we see the French valuing it in the form of the Jacobins during the French Revolution also. But there's a very interesting link to Scottish royalty in northern Spain, where the Camino de Santiago is located, in Santiago de Compostela. We've already seen how many of the follies at Shugborough Hall point the way to places important to the lore of the Camino. So this is very interesting, as well as part of the tale of Sir Douglas bringing Robert the Bruce's heart to Spain includes them visiting Santiago de Compostela first, which is the sepulcher of St. James. And part of the legend of Robert the Bruce's heart involves him wanting his heart to be brought to the, quote, Holy Sepulchre. Now, is the Sepulchre of St. James is what is considered by Robert the Bruce to be the, quote, Holy Sepulchre? So that's a possibility. There are many strange things to the story of the Battle of Teba, and we'll have more on that in further installments. Now, some other important connections between northern Spain, or the area of the Camino de Santiago, or Way of St. James, includes the legend of Queen Scota, the origins of the Scottish culture. Scota and her king lived in northern Spain and were said to have dwelt in A Coruña, where the Torre de Hercules is today. And the legend goes that her husband, the king, sighted Ireland from a tower in A Coruña, and the Torre de Hercules may have been built to commemorate this. But we know the story of the Leofale, which must have been with her in Spain at one point, making its way to the Hill of Tara, where Scota either defeated the Tuatha De Dan or were part of that tribe as well. And we see them then migrating to Scotland and establishing that culture and tradition there. So what we see starting to develop here at Amiens Cathedral is the fact that it may be part of the entire mystery of Rain-Lash Chateau, Santiago de Compostela, the Great Cross of Hendaye, Girona, Spain, and many other places. Indeed, all of these places may be linked together via a similar philosophy and appreciation of the Camino de Santiago and Santiago de Compostela. We have distinct different views of the Camino coming from Scotland and France and Spain, but they all seem to center around a value of knighthoods and Masonic values and royal values. Now, what's really interesting, the Battle of Teba was Sir James Douglas, or the Black Douglas, carrying Robert the Bruce's heart into battle against the Moors at the Fortress of the Stars there in Teba. And that's an interesting association with the symbols of the Douglas family themselves, who may have possibly even inspired the American flag. The blue field with three white stars, coupled with his value of Santiago de Compostela, which Compostela means field of stars as well, and that's a pattern that's present on the United States flag. Later we even see John Adams and his then son John Quincy Adams somehow traveling the Camino backwards, just like an initiate would. Due to what was said to be a leaky boat, he traveled the Camino from Finisterre all the way to Paris through Spain and north to Paris through France. So that's very interesting. And as I said, his son, future President John Quincy Adams, accompanied him. And one may wonder if his more Masonic-oriented brethren arranged this to expose him to the influences of the Camino itself. So that's an interesting concept, and John Adams did emerge admiring the Camino and the pilgrims, while he had less than favorable things to say about, quote, ecclesiastical figures, spelled with a K. So John Adams may have been just being exposed by people like Thomas Jefferson and James Madison to the concepts that they had been exposed to before, so he may at least appreciate them, but it's interesting that they likely did not tell him what they were doing. So really, what does all of this mean? And what does it mean in the context of United States history? We do see John Adams also being minister to France, like Thomas Jefferson was as well, and Benjamin Franklin, who are obviously exposed to Masonic concepts and members of French lodges. But what's interesting, we'll see, this will just be a teaser here, because all this information will be featured in my next book. And we'll see some unique spatial relationships between architecture that Thomas Jefferson built and those discussed in Mystery of the Cathedrals. We'll also, more will be revealed about Ronda, Spain, and the Palacio Salvatierra and the Palacio de Montezuma that are located there, with their artwork that echoes that of the Great Cross of Ondé. The templum that I calculated for the Great Cross based on the instructions that are emblazoned on the cross to do so led me to Ronda, Spain, and I had a unique experience with my friend John Tudor and Sally Tudor, who actually went to Ronda, Spain, and discovered some of these things for me, because I had already discerned that there was some importance there. So I thank them very much. If it weren't for them, I wouldn't have found Palacio de Salvatierra or Montezuma, and all of the links I found between them and Alexander von Humboldt and the Aztec Sunstone, and ultimately it being featured on the United States Capitol Rotunda. And it all links to the 2012 phenomena and the appreciation of millennial monuments like what the Georgia Guidestones are. So these are one of the tenets of these men's beliefs. And really what they may view these buildings as well are markers of their domain or influence, whether real or symbolic. And also physical markers on the face of the earth that will survive a catastrophe as well. So built into places like the Georgia Guidestones and the Great Cross of Ondé are clues that will let you discover them. And the clues will lead you from place to place where you may learn different things in a manner similar to an initiation, or what the Native Americans call a vision quest. So there's a lot to learn there. And really, you can discern many true things about history and society and the development of technology during past eras by examining this. A lot of it is hidden in metaphor and allegory and alchemical values and Christian values. The Roman Catholic Church does this themselves. We see the array of windrows and obelisks at St. Peter's being a classic example of how these things work. And what they're really doing is constructing a map projection where they can accurately map an area, you really up to about 400 miles from the center point, until the distortion becomes too great that you'll have to start calculating the arc or curvature of the earth. And they also became adept at that. And that's a good point to discuss, because what we may see here is some of the things that are contributing to a lot of people's theories that there's a breakaway civilization. Here we have a prime example of a very important technology being cloistered and hidden at different times. And you can even discern that it's being rediscovered at different times in history as well. So join me for more, and please keep your eyes peeled for my next book, which will be a follow-up to my last book, Axis Mundi. I'll expand on many of the things in the book, including the Three Tower of the Winds reproductions in England, and the King's Knot at Stirling Castle that also has a unique relationship to what we have discussed in this video. We have a southerly azimuth from the octagon of the King's Knot extending to Ronda, Spain, to complete the loop, so to speak, of this mystery and why some of the unique esoteric architecture and artwork is present there. And note also that Stirling, the King's Knot at Stirling, points to the Dome of the Rock, just as Amiens Cathedral does. And that's very symbolic, possibly in the association earlier of Amiens pointing to the Battle of Teba. This might have been all arranged and all set up to be what it was, kind of a ritual involving the heart of the king. So join me soon for more. Keep your eyes peeled for my book. It'll be out within 2 months of the date of this video. And all these questions will be answered. A lot of the mysteries won't be solved, but there'll be a significant more amount of clues and information that may help you interpret what you have found at places like Rennes-le-Château or elsewhere. Thanks a lot for being here.